Good morning, everyone. Today we have among us Professor Sriram to discuss and talk about on his views on the economic and financial inclusion in our country. Professor Sriram is a distinguished fellow of Institute of Development of Research in Banking Technology. Before this, he worked as an independent consultant. Professor Sriram was earlier a faculty at IIM Ahmedabad before joining IIM Bangalore. He was the faculty of the Institute of Rural Management, Anand, for 6 years. Professor Sriram did significant work on cooperatives when he was at IRMA. Moving on to the first question for today. India as a country moved from primary to services sector, right? And this growth has been pretty different from what we experienced in US and what also China went through. And this has led to the creation of a lot of jobs in that countries. There has been several job crunch in our country, in our economy, as manufacturing sector has traditionally created a lot of unskilled jobs. So how do you suggest we move forward as a country where we are not able to create jobs, which is one issue, and the second issue is providing high wages to our workers?
Well, I think we have leapfrogged, you're right, we have leapfrogged from agriculture. We have not really leapfrogged from agriculture to services. The services sector has expanded disproportionately compared to the manufacturing sector. But I can't say that we have leapfrogged because we have not shrunk the agricultural sector proportionately. So therefore, what we have is a large contribution of GDP coming from the services sector, but not providing the same number of jobs. So therefore, you have very highly paid services sector jobs, and therefore, our inequality is also increasing because agriculture, people continue to live in agriculture, in the agricultural sector, and are not getting adequate wages, and the per capita agricultural income is reducing, and you can see fragmentation of land, holding sizes are going down, and so on. We certainly need to look at how can we get people out of agriculture into alternative sectors. The problem with the manufacturing sector as we are going forward is that at one stage, when the examples that you took were where there was a good employment multiplier for every rupee or every dollar of investment made in the manufacturing sector, it would create jobs. The manufacturing sector itself is getting more and more technologically advanced, and therefore the greater the capital you invest in manufacturing, the lesser per dollar of job creation that happens. That's why we keep talking about jobless growth. So we need to look at this in a completely different perspective, and possibly one way to look at it is to see whether we can have decentralized production, large number of small and medium enterprises, rather than look at large manufacturing units. But then the question is, what happens to the competitiveness of these large number of small and medium enterprises? So it's a tough problem. Yes.
Thank you, sir. Moving on to the second question and taking forward about the large small organizations that you are talking about. India's major share of people work in informal sector even today, and we have a very little organized sector in our country. This creates problems on two scales. One is that there is lack of regulation on the informal sector, with exploitation of workers both related to the wages paid and difficulty of getting insured, including government schemes. And the second problem is there is very less incentives for company to move into the formal sector, since they will have to pay more taxes over there and follow a variety of complex and complicated rules that we have in our country. Yes, GST is a way forward towards that, but we still need to go a long way towards that. With government coming up with another step like demonetization to try and bring people out of it and towards formalization, how do you think these schemes have helped our country? And also, what are the possible steps that government can take forward in future to move from an informal sector, unorganized sector, towards more of an organized sector?
It's a fairly complex question. Is it desirable for people to move from informal sector to formal sector? The answer is yes. Why people should move from informal to formal is essentially because when you are in the informal sector, you don't get counted. You are not data. So even policy making becomes difficult because you're doing that only on the basis of some estimates and so on. So what getting into the formal sector means that you get identified, you get recognized, there is some sort of a social security cover that can be given once you're identified. market. So therefore, it is necessary for us to get into the farming sector. Now, how do you get into the farming sector is a question that we can answer. I guess one way is to still identify people into the formal sector but not necessarily working in the formal sector. For example, I could have a bank account and I could have an identity and I could be engaging and talking to the government through certain schemes wherein I am engaging in the formal sector but my work could be in the informal sector. So, you know, that's certainly possible. But what could the government do to get more and more people into the formal sector is a little bit of a complex problem. I will not touch upon demonetization because I don't think that was a initiative that was aimed at getting people from the formal sector. In any case, even if it was, it was an ineffective blunt tool to get people from the informal to the formal. But GST, yes. GST, yes, essentially because you are now saying that there will be one tax and there will be input credit towards that. What it does is, all those exemptions that were there in the past and all those incentives were there that were there in the past not to be in the tax bracket is now removed because you could be in the tax bracket and still get input credit and tax credit and so on. So therefore, it's in a way aiding formalization of the informal sector. But at the same time, we need to see how we are bringing the informal sector into the formal sector, and in the process, is the cost of compliance itself making the business infeasible? That's a question that we need to engage with. You know, because, for example, the handloom sector is up in arms saying that why are you putting us under the GST regime? A whole range of large amount of traders who work on very wafer thin margins, but make it up with volumes, will find it extremely difficult to file returns because it's not just about it being low cost, because while the tax might be zero, the compliance cost is added on. You know, so therefore you need somebody to help you to file the returns, you need to pay your tax upfront and then wait for tax credit and so on. So there is a whole range of compliance requirements which will cost. So that cost itself might make the informal sector, some of the businesses of the informal sector, infeasible. So I think that needs to be handled very carefully, and my own suspicion is, I think GST as a concept is great, but it should have been rolled out very, very gradually over a period of 5 to 6 years rather than the time frame that the current government has.
Sir, moving on to the next question. We know that Indian agricultural sector is very important, as more than 50% of the population is still in agricultural sector and derives its livelihood from that. So, in the primary sector, what the credit is very important, and we know that most of the credit to them goes on from informal sector, from money lenders, where who charge high rate of interest. So, from to buy seeds, equipment, and till harvest, there is a time lag. So, for that, there is a very important need of getting farmers credit at the right time. So, what can be done to make financial credit more inclusive to this sector? And what can be the role of SHGs, NABARD and Grameen Bank initiative, like it was in Bangladesh and it was very successful, so can it be replicated in India?
Policy of the government has been, and the Reserve Bank of India has been, that agriculture should get about 80% of the banks as adjusted net bank credit, but there have been problems in definition of what agricultural finance is, and therefore you will find Mumbai Metropolitan Bank also having an exposure for agriculture, essentially because agriculture is divided into direct and indirect, and the definition of what direct agriculture is itself has been a little touchy. But there is focus in the sense that the policy is seized of this issue. The second is, it's not that the credit is not available, but we have not adequately address the issue of the lucrativeness of agriculture, and credit will naturally flow if agriculture is economically viable. And I think that problem is something that where we have not found a very effective solution. So look at agriculture. Agriculture has two sorts of risks. One is the yield risk, the second is the price risk. Now yield risk is higher, that risk is higher than any other business, essentially because all other businesses have market-based risk. Agriculture has nature-based risk. You know, excessive rainfall in one season in one location is sufficient to reduce the productivity of the crop, right? Or too much of temperature is sufficient. I mean, it just doesn't get captured, you know, and you can't control for this. So therefore, it has greater yield risk. Second is, it has a price risk, which can be addressed through policy and intervention. But the problem is, when you look at the agricultural prices, it has direct implication in inflation. So therefore, farmers are one set of people who never have the upside of good price, because if there is a good price, it affects the consumer interest and it affects inflation, and inflation affects large number of people. So it's a very, very difficult problem. One way to look at this issue is to try and consolidate agricultural land holdings and make the unit much more viable, so that as the unit, it can negotiate risk better, it can negotiate technology better, and so on. The units are getting fragmented. But please also remember, agriculture is very sentimental. There's great amount of attachment to land. So therefore, what could be an obvious solution is not a practical solution, right? Consolidation is not a practical solution, because there are real feelings and attachment and legacy and things like that involved. So the only way that the state should address this, and it's related to your question on manufacturing and services, is to create large scale employment opportunities outside of agriculture, which takes pressure off agriculture and people will naturally move. So if that imbalance is there, wherein your wage employment is giving you higher returns and you sort of leave agriculture and go, then the pressure on agriculture and the adverse terms of trade that agriculture has gets evened out a little bit. So possibly our solution is not in agriculture for agriculture.
So moving on to the next question. Government of India is running Digital India campaign, and one of its initiatives is GEM, to improve serviceability. So in PDS system, there have been a lot of inefficiencies and exclusion and inclusion errors. So, but GEM also comes with its own set of challenges. Like, there have been general accounts, but many of them have been lying dormant and people are not doing any activities in it. In addition to that, it will need for PDS POS machines to capture, and they are not available in many places. So what do you think are the improvements which can be done in this thing, and how can these challenges be sorted out? So okay, especially related to PDS situations.
Okay. Let's again break this problem into its components. You know, there are two elements here. One element is, what is your identity, and are you faking your identity to get it? So therefore, am I giving you something which you don't deserve? You know, when we are talking of misuse, etc., etc., you are basically saying that you are giving something to somebody who doesn't deserve it, right? That is one part of it. The other part of it is, are we including all those who deserve it? So that's one part of it. So what Aadhaar has done, or what Jandan has done, and this has done, is it has made possible identification better. Look, but please remember that identification is only the identification of a person. Are you who you claim to be? It doesn't identify whether you are poor or not. It doesn't identify whether you are eligible for a senior citizen thing, whether you are a widow or not, right? It only identifies who you claim to be. Now, the rest of the classification happens outside of the Aadhaar system, right? Now, that is something that needs a fix. I mean, if we have not fixed that, and we are saying, oh, no, you know, this is a great technology. Of course, it's a great technology to weed out somebody who claims that they are not what they are. That's all. That's the only fix that Aadhaar gives, right? So therefore, when you are looking at PDS, you need to look at it holistically to say, what is the eligibility criteria, what is the definition of poverty, who will be eligible for PDS, and so on. And then you can weed out. So in this entire thing, I would think that the policy should be much more towards streamlining the PDS at the first instance, and trying to include as many eligible people as they are, rather than excluding people on the basis of things. So I think what Aadhaar has done is it's disrupted this process and somehow got this feeling that technology will solve all the problems. So technology solves only the identification problem. It doesn't solve the eligibility problem, right? So that's one part of it. What Jandan and mobile and Aadhaar, the Trinity does, is it gives a better possibility of doing cash transfers if you want. Now, there is always a big debate on whether it is good to do cash transfers or should we do, you know, particularly in the context of PDS. Now, why is it an issue? For example, if you are looking at cash is fungible. So therefore, once the cash gets into the account, it could be used for any purpose. Whereas if I give you food grain, it becomes a little more difficult for you to convert it into cash and use it to some other purpose. And most likely, you would use it for your consumption purpose. Now, if you go back and look at some research, one of it is a little dated by Bhavaskar and Shanti George, which they did in Gujarat, wherein they found that people, dairy farmers, selling milk to Amul, their families were malnourished. Now, it's a very interesting paradox. They were rich, but they were malnourished. Why were they malnourished? Because they had a commercial opportunity of selling all the milk, and therefore they were not consuming adequate amount of proteins within the family. Right? So, to say that I'll give you cash and cash will solve the nutrition problem or the protein problem, I don't know. It might not. It might give you choices. It might help you to go ahead with your food practices. For example, in Karnataka, under the Annabhagya scheme, they give rice, and people in Mandya are asking, we are ragi eaters, why should we give it? So, DCT will help you to convert the cash into ragi. So it's a very interesting paradox, and I don't think we have sorted out that, but direct cash transfer helps us to do that. In fact, I would argue that this jam architecture would have been very effective to have a much better farmer subsidy system than the loan waiver that the Karnataka government recently introduced. I'd argue that it might be better to do a direct cash transfer of 10,000 rupees or 15,000 rupees per farmer rather than do a waiver, because then that's a uniform amount, which essentially means that it gives an equal amount but treats unequals unequally. You know, if you are a farmer who has taken a 10,000 rupee loan, you get 15,000 rupees. If you are a farmer who has taken a 100,000 rupee loan, you still get 15,000 rupees. It sort of equalizes it, which means it gives lesser subsidy to richer farmers and higher subsidy to whom. So that architecture can be used in very interesting ways. But whether it should be used for PDS is a moot question. I mean, that lot more people have to weigh in on this, and it's not an easy answer. It's a very difficult answer.
So thanks for your views on the topic today. I guess we had a lot of insightful information, and we as a country together can move forward to achieve more of a financial and economic inclusion. Thanks for your views.
Thank you.